Thanks for joining us. We're in conversation with the top management team of TCS, Rajesh Gopinathan, CFO, Ajoy Mukherjee, Head of HR. Gentlemen, many thanks for joining us on Bloomberg. Rajesh, let me begin this conversation by asking you about your own top line growth. 6.4%. If you strip the Japanese acquisition, would you say your top line has grown as per expectations?
So, quite frankly, the top line is fairly good growth. It is a bit lower than what we would have ideally liked it to be. But if you really get down into the details of the growth across sectors, we had fairly decent growth. So US has come in at a strong 4%. We have good growth in BFS. And though we have some softness on the insurance side, BFSI at an aggregate has come in close to 4% again. We have good growth across both Europe and UK.
Sure.
It is dragged down by cross currency, but adjusted for that, they're growing at about 4.5 to 6.5. So that's great. We've got good growth across enterprise solutions, infrastructure services. So all in all, it's a fairly holistic growth.
Sure.
In aggregate, maybe it's a bit off what we would have wanted it.
Sure.
But structurally, it's fairly good.
Rajesh, you know, we're talking at a time when there is the risk of a global slowdown or the recovery not being fast enough resurfacing. From the events of the last quarter, what is the evidence on the ground? Are you seeing businesses ramp up? Is there confidence in earmarking fresh budgets?
Actually, we are at that point where budget decisions are just about to start getting made. Mm. But these are confusing signals because we were in US last 2-3 weeks back. Mm. And underlying sentiment in US continues to be very positive. Mm. And if you look at it from a US perspective, they're talking about a 4% GDP growth.
Correct.
And that's huge for that economy.
Correct.
For the size that it is on. Mm. The question is, where is the pull through at the bottom, right? And then maybe when you look further afield, it is a bit more gray across this thing. So I wouldn't say that we are at a level where the sentiment has turned negative at a global level. Mm. There are pockets of weakness,
sure.
And these have been structurally weak areas.
Mm.
But overall sentiment still continues to be positive.
Mm.
However, the next 2-3 months are critical because that's when the budgeting decisions get made.
Sure.
But we are going in without too much of an overhang,
sure.
Except for the last couple of weeks when we have started seeing some amount of macro discussions being made.
Sure.
But at the ground level, we have seen fairly positive sentiment.
Ajoy, at the beginning of the year, you'd said that you'd want to hire about 55,000 for the whole of this financial year. How much has been done so far? And with whatever you've seen on demand, is there a case to review?
See, overall, we said 55,000 will be the total hiring as
Correct.
Far as this year is concerned.
Correct.
First quarter, I think we did about 15,800, and now I've done 20,300. So mm-hmm. overall, we are just over 36,000 at this point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as our total hiring is concerned, we are still sticking to the standard, it will be 55,000, but most likely we will overshoot. But at this point in time, we have not really calibrated what that number is going to be. So it's at 55,000 is what we are working with at this point in time.
You made an observation about your utilization levels.
Right.
Yes, you're at record levels both last quarter and this quarter as in you know, sequentially. Does it make sense to be measuring utilization the way it's currently being done? What does it really indicate?
Okay. So utilization, if we just come to the crux of it, it primarily indicates of the total number of people that you have.
Correct.
What is the volume that is, or the number of people who are working on customer engagements?
Mm.
Okay, so this is a measure from that point of view.
Sure.
Now, whether it is from a percentage point of view, whether it is right or wrong, and that would depend upon the evolution of an organization over a period of time.
Mm.
Today, given our scale, I think that is an advantage that we have.
Mm.
And at that scale, as we have been saying over the last few quarters, that if you look at percentage point of view, because the question keeps coming, you're just increasing it 83, 84,
Correct.
85. Now, how much can you really go to?
Right.
See, primarily, what we have is the investment that we want to make. And that, I think Rajesh has been making that point fairly well, that over depending upon the way the currency fluctuates, et cetera, and whatever gain you have,
sure.
we would like to invest in our business.
Right.
So what is the investment that you want to make? Based on that, you calibrate. What is what manpower do you need for that kind of research, for that kind of management, for that kind of new activity that you want to do?
Sure.
The rest, you want to carry a certain amount of bench
yeah.
because you have to grow. So you need that headcount at any given point in time.
Right.
Right. And the rest will be on customer engagement. So mm-hmm. as your size increases, So you have a good amount of capacity that you can play with. Mm-hmm. So that utilization of 86% at this point in time looks pretty good for us.
A question about profitability. Your margins are about 26.8. Pretty much in the same band that you've been for a while now. What could be the kickers for profitability?
See, if you actually look at our margin journey, so if you go back about a year back, we were at about 30%, right? And we said that we're going to calibrate our investments based on the headroom that the currency gives us.
Right.
And through the course of the year, we have systematically invested in expanding market access. We consolidated France, we consolidated Japan. We have continued to aggressively invest into the infrastructure services service line. We have invested into digital services. And we have essentially used up some of that headroom and still have managed to keep our margins within the fairly tight band or the middle point of that band. So the focus on the band is not to increase margins. The focus is to maintain the margin band. If the currency were to turn down.
So right, this is irrespective of how the demand playing out?
See, in the absence of a very volatile spike, we are very confident about it. If you were to see some kind of a big fall off, then obviously all bets are off and we need some time to recalibrate and stabilize.
What would be the size of your hedge book right now and how long you hedge for?
We are slightly more than $4.5 billion. Again, split approximately equally between forwards and options, between receivables and revenue. And we continue to be the similar kind of pattern that we have. It's essentially about two quarters forward and weighted more to the shorter end of it.
One question about attrition as well, Ajoy. Would you say that you're comfortable with these levels of attrition at this point in time?
Yeah, at this point in time, the cyclically Q1 and Q2, the attrition usually goes up. Primarily a couple of reasons. One is people do leave for higher studies, and we do complete our appraisal cycle and everything else by end of March. So there is during these two quarters, the attrition goes up. So that is what is happening at this point in time. It's gone up from 12 to 12.8. Now the question is, what is the right level of attrition? So that's a difficult one. So we would like everybody to continue and, and grow with the organization. That is what we basically hire people so that they can make a career within TCS. But there is some amount of attrition is definitely healthy. And going forward, where it's going to be, but I think the attrition is going to come down because if you look at August and September, and it has been consistently coming down over a period of time. But this attrition measure is last 12 months. So that is the way it is calculated. And if you look at quarterly attrition, again, between Q1 and Q2, it will be high, but then Q3, Q4, it's going to come down.
Rajesh, what about pricing? I remember the last time we spoke, you said you didn't see too much of uptick taking place for the rest of the financial year. Would you hold a similar view in specific geographies like the United States, where you are seeing demand sort of pick up significantly?
Absolutely, because as I said, the demand pickup is rather a sentiment and the demand pickup is more sporadic. We would need to see a few quarters of very strong demand for us to start looking at a pricing uptick. Right now it's a fairly narrow, stable band.
Would you hold a similar view for other markets as well?
Other markets, the depth of the market is not big enough for us to judge whether the pricing is in. For example, we typically on the, if you were to say local market rates in some of the markets like Europe, etc., it's much higher than where the global averages are. So to some extent, we end up deflating the price points in those local markets. So it's very difficult for us to judge what the base pricing momentum is. Whereas in the US market, it's a much more stable market, so you're able to get better signals in terms of where the pricing trends are going.
I just want to push this a little further. When you talk about digital projects and digital businesses, is that a more profitable business? Is there scope for pricing increases because of the size of the deals? Just explain this to me.
Any new service line, and especially a hot new service line like digital, typically comes in at a realization point that is better than your stable services.
At a better realization point.
At a better realization point. But when you talk about profitability, remember that these are early periods for these services.
So you're investing.
You're investing. You don't have the scale for the economies there. So profitability is a more tricky one because typically the profitability tends to lag it. So these are two different metrics.
A question about the amalgamation with CMC. How does it rub off the business impact of it on your own books?
On the books, the business impact is very marginal. Mm. So essentially what will happen is that we have about the minority interest, which goes off just below the net profit,
sure,
will disappear and get replaced into EPS.
Mm.
So EPS, looking at the last trailing 12 quarters, rather trailing 12 months, is marginally positive, but we are talking about a few paise up or down.
Sure.
So that's where it is. So that's the books impact. Otherwise, on the balance sheet side, there's not too much of a one. It will get set off against the reserves, no goodwill creation, etc.
Sure. One final question, Rajesh, and this is with respect to, you know, what's happening in the large deals. I noticed that this time you there weren't too many large $100 million deals, but there were many in the mid-sized deals. Is that indicative of how you see demand playing out for the rest of the financial year, or is this, am I reading too much?
No, I think it's just not.
Because
not
you had trend large deals last quarter.
Yeah, I don't think. The pipeline continues to be strong, and the pipeline's nature of the pipeline, which is more project-specific in US and more outsourcing in UK, Europe, or other continental Europe, that nature continues. So we are not, I wouldn't read too much into it.
Across all the verticals also, the pipeline looks fairly healthy.
Actually, it's very well distributed across the verticals. So I would say that the pipeline continues to be quite healthy.